So the Department of Justice has actually sued Facebook, not for antitrust charges, at least yet, but for discriminating against American workers on the basis of H-1Bs. This is something I've talked to you about the show, but it's part of immigration law, which doesn't get nearly enough attention. Let's throw this up there on the screen. So the DOJ says that Facebook, in the case of 2,600 positions, filled those roles with temporary visa holders in a discrimination against American workers. So these were 2,600 positions with an average salary of about $156,000, according to the Department of Justice. They say, quote, Facebook intentionally created a hiring system in which it denied qualified U.S. workers a fair opportunity to learn about and apply for jobs at Facebook instead, sought to channel to temporary visa holders Facebook wanted to sponsor for green cards. Now, Facebook, to be fair, before I bring Ryan in here, has said, quote, they have been cooperating with the DOJ in its review, and they dispute the allegations in the complaint, and we cannot comment further on pending litigation. Ryan, the reason I wanted to highlight this is I think a lot of the immigration discourse and all of that is focused on low-skilled immigration, and, you know, there's a lot more emotions surrounding that. But this is actually a clear-cut case where big tech companies and big corporations write our immigration laws and work the system in such a way that they can discriminate against American workers simply in order. It's a bad deal for everybody, right? Which is that the workers themselves are locked in. They literally can't leave, or they're going to lose their visa. And so they get paid less. And in exchange for staying less, they get to stay in the United States. But then an American would have more job mobility, doesn't get the job, simply because of their own citizenship. It's just like a complete mess. And you can see this. I mean, Facebook is just like the tip of the iceberg in what a lot of, not just high tech, but Accenture, these consulting firms, a lot of them do this. I call it visa arbitrage.
Right. And that's right. What the companies do is they use the power of the state, and they use the power of immigration laws, both to exploit the immigrant workers, like you said, because they can, because the arbitrage between, you know, what they can make back at home versus what they can make here is so huge that they're then willing to take less than an American worker would take, and they're willing to suffer much worse working conditions on a day-to-day basis, but also worse conditions in the sense that you described, which is that if things aren't going well for you, you can move to another job in the United States. Like that's part of our social contract, and it's why so much attention is placed on the unemployment rate, because the lower the unemployment rate is, then the more power workers have to say, you know what, stop trying to make me work weekends without compensating me for it. If you do, I'm going to go somewhere else. When the unemployment rate is over 10%, workers don't have that power because they're just so grateful to have that job. And so what this law does is it artificially places that boot on the neck of the worker, because they simply legally can't leave, which is utterly absurd. And, you know, say whatever you want about everything else, the idea that a worker can't move from one job to another is just fundamentally a human rights violation.
Yeah, and so it's bad for the worker and it's bad for Americans. It's one of these things. And again, the only person it's good for is the bottom line of Facebook, right? And Facebook, if you can pay each one of them 15 grand less, that's 2,600. You do the math. That's a lot of money. And you scale that across everybody. This is another thing. This is a big thing with libertarians, right? Which is that ultimately what they want to do is just lower the cost to the corporation. They don't really care about the wage of the worker themselves, or in this case, I think fundamentally the rights of the citizen. This is something pushed by Senator Mike Lee. Let's throw this up there on the screen that just passed in the United States Senate, which is stamping out something called a per country cap for work-based visas. Now, look, based upon my own heritage, everyone would be like, Sagar, why are you talking about this? Because the primary people that it supposedly discriminates against are Indian nationals and Pakistani nationals. But this per country cap and so much more being lifted disproportionately helps whom? People in the tech industry, specifically in order to fast track these green cards and these visas for the workers that they get in this particular program, which is displacing Americans. And, you know, this again is where identity and all this gets packed in. There's a huge Indian lobby, you know, for this type of stuff, because, of course, you know, they want to write the laws in a way that's going to benefit them. But you got to think in terms of country first. And I just think this is, again, Ryan, where I think this is actually an area where old school left labor and right wing can be at least see the same problem, which is that this is not good for anyone when you're locked into a corporation and you literally can't leave because then you're going to lose your visa. And say you have like a kid and you got a wife and like you're like, hey, you know, let's say your boss is terrible. Any American citizen with our rights can just get up and say, screw you, I'm going to Google or whatever. But you can't do that when you're an immigrant and then an American doesn't get the job. You know, they love to say, oh, there's not enough qualified Americans. That's BS. It's totally wrong. And what they're doing instead is this is just corporatized system, which is bad for everyone. It's the same thing in actually many ways in the low skilled system and in the high skill system. And it's not a surprise to see libertarianism once again line up behind big business.
Right. The old school labor approach to this was to be rather hostile to immigrant labor for the general reason they felt like, immigrants in the 1800s, early 1900s were used by companies as kind of like a reserve army to help break strikes. And a lot of the partisan politics of that era broke down around these immigration lines. I learned this fascinating nugget recently about the 13th Amendment the 14th Amendment that gave freed slaves the right to vote and citizenship. Yeah. What they did is there was an amendment that was pushed by some radical Republicans that said everybody has the right to vote. That got like five votes in the Senate, and instead they put in a compromise that said you can't be denied the right to vote based on previous servitude. But because it was written that way, there were other ways that you could deny people the right to vote, poll taxes, et cetera. And eventually poll taxes came in. The reason Republicans wanted to do that is because they didn't want Irish immigrants in the Northeast, and they didn't want Chinese immigrants in the West voting, because those blocks at the time were voting Democratic. And for a lot of the reasons that you talked about. Now, the new labor approach to this is to look at the situation more globally and with a more human rights frame. The way I would view it is a bit different than you, which is to say that, look, if somebody wants to apply for a job in Silicon Valley from anywhere in the world, let them apply, but have them apply on an equal footing. The company cannot exploit them. If they get the job, they have to be paid the same that an American worker would be paid, and they have the same rights and freedoms that an American worker would have, and that would push wages up, and it would also restore a social contract, with Silicon Valley and the rest of the country, where they would now actually be invested in trying to create a stronger tech labor force here in the United States. So Facebook might actually care about the student debt crisis, might actually care, that going to college is so difficult for people, that high schools are failing all over the country. And if you had that type of a social contract, that type of a buy-in, then maybe you make some progress on this front instead of having this bizarre economic apartheid going on.
Yeah, exactly. And look, we can argue about the latter part later. I think there are jobs and our people should have a first shot, but that's fine. At least let's fix this current system now. Mm-hmm. And it's just same thing, corporatized immigration, not a surprise. Anyway, we'll have more Rising for everybody right after this.